chochote utataka nitakupa ma.
Said, ثُمَّ رُفِعَ لِي الْبَيْتُ الْمَعْمُورِ. Then I saw الْبَيْتُ الْمَعْمُورِ. In one hadith it says that, so I passed basically Ibrahim in the seventh heaven, and then I saw Sidrat al-Muntaha. In the other hadith in Sahih Muslim, the Prophet said, and then I went to Sidrat al-Muntaha, and it is in the sixth heavens. Imam An-Nawawi tries to explain this, and it seems like a good explanation. The trunk of the tree begins in the sixth heaven, but its branches finish at the end of the seventh heaven. Nothing of the creation of this world, at least, is beyond the Sidrat al-Muntaha, right? The only thing that is beyond it is the throne and the one who is above the throne. And then he saw Jibreel alayhi salam in his original form. Jibreel had 600 wings. He blocked the entire horizons. And he said in another hadith in At-Tabari, from the feathers of Jibreel's wings, pearls and corals were dripping. Allah says in the Quran, most of the angels, Allah says, two or three or four wings. But Jibreel alayhi salam, in this hadith we learn he has 600 wings. Three things he saw one after the other at the highest level. Number one, Sidrat al-Muntaha. Number two, Baytul Ma'mur. Number three, Jibreel. This is the reference in the Quran, لَقَدْ رَأَى مِنْ آيَاتِ رَبِّهِ الْكُبْرَى. He saw of his major signs. And it is said that the Prophet ﷺ only saw Jibreel in his original form twice. Then Ibn Mas'ud said, the Prophet ﷺ was given three things. Number one, the five salah. We're going to come to that. Number two, خَوَاتِيمُ سُورَةِ الْبَقَرَةِ. The ending of Surah Al-Baqarah. And number three, Allah promised him that whoever worshipped him from his ummah without doing shirk, that he will be forgiven and caused to enter Jannah. And the Prophet ﷺ said that the last two verses of Surah Al-Baqarah, I have been given them from underneath the throne of the treasure of Allah. And we know that whoever recites these two verses, Allah will protect him. In another hadith he said, whoever recites these two verses on a nightly basis, يعني كفتاهو, they're going to be enough for him. He doesn't need anything else. It was then that the Prophet ﷺ went to the gist of Al-Isra, and that is the divine appointment. In Sahih Bukhari, the Prophet ﷺ says, then I was caused to ascend forth in the singular, not Jibreel anymore. And I rose to a level where I could hear the pen writing. As the Prophet ﷺ said, the first thing that Allah created was the pen. And then Allah told the pen, Uktub. So the pen asked Allah, what should I write? And Allah said, write everything that will happen until the end, until Yawm al-Qiyamah. Write everything. He went beyond Jibreel. He went beyond even the Sidrat al-Muntaha. And he heard the divine pen as it was writing in the book that Allah Azza wa Jal has with him. There is a book that Allah has above the throne. And therefore, it is, inshallah, legitimate to say that the Prophet ﷺ went to a level that no living creature has ever been to, as far as we know. But we don't have any details about what was said except for the 50 salawat. That Allah Azza wa Jal, فُرِضَتْ عَلَيَّ, the Prophet ﷺ said, فُرِضَتْ عَلَيَّ الصَّلَوَاتُ خَمْسِينَ صَلَاتًا كُلَّ يَوْمٍ. 50 salawat every single day. And he goes back down and he meets Musa. What did your Lord tell you for your ummah? So here the Prophet ﷺ says that my Lord told me that I should tell my ummah to pray 50 times a day. Here Musa says, go back to your Lord and tell him to lower this, because I have more experience than you with the Bani Israel, and your ummah will not be able to do 50 times a day. The Prophet ﷺ looked at Jibreel wanting to get his opinion. فَأَنَّهُ يَسْتَشِيرُهُ, the riwayah says, as if he's getting his opinion. And Jibreel nodded to him, yes, do that. So the Prophet ﷺ went back up. Now here is where the riwayah differ. Some of them say it went down 5, 5, 5. Others say it went down 10, 10, 10. But really the point is the same. And that is multiple times back and forth, at least 5 times. And every time Musa is telling him the same thing, that go back to your Lord and ask him to lower it, because I have tested the children of Israel and they will not be able to do this. Your ummah will not be able to do this. Until finally when he came back down with 5, this was when Musa said it one more time, and the Prophet ﷺ said, I have gone back and forth until I am embarrassed now, but I am content and happy. So when he said this, a voice called out, and this is the voice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My fariḍah has been established, and I have made things easier for my servants. It is 5, but it shall be rewarded with 50. So the messenger is summoned to the presence of the divine. And what is then decreed? And that is the salah. It was so important that the messenger was called to the King of Kings to receive the message directly from the divine. There is a controversy, did he see Allah or not? The strongest opinion, as we'll talk about, he did not see Allah, but he had a private meeting in which he saw the veil of Allah. And this is clearly proven that Abu Dharr al-Ghifari radiallahu ta'ala an asked him directly, did you see your Lord? And the Prophet responded, there was light. How could I see him? There was the light of Allah's hijab. Because another hadith of Sahih Muslim says, Allah has a hijab of nur. If Allah were to lift this veil, then the rays that come from His face would destroy everything that it sees. The beginning portions of Surah An-Najm describe certain of these incidents. وَالنَّجْمِ إِذَا هَوَى مَا ضَلَّ صَاحِبُكُمْ وَمَا غَوَى وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَى, that when the star, when it goes down, your companion has neither gone astray nor has he erred, and he's not speaking from his imagination. What he is saying, إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَى, this is wahi from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not just the Quran, everything that he's seeing is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. عَلَّمَهُ شَدِيدُ الْقُوَى, he has been taught by the one who is mighty in power. The reference is Jibreel. مِرَّةٍ فَاسْتَوَى. ذُو مِرَّة means he is free of any defect. فَاسْتَوَى وَهُوَ بِالْأُفُقِ الْأَعْلَى means Jibreel revealed himself at the highest of heavens. ثُمَّ دَنَا فَتَدَلَّى, and then Jibreel came closer and closer. فَكَانَ قَابَ قَوْسَيْنِ أَوْ أَدَنَى, Jibreel was closer to the Prophet ﷺ than two bows length, you know, bow and arrow. فَأَوْحَى إِلَىٰ عَبْدِهِ مَا أَوْحَى, after the encounter with Jibreel, he moved on to an even higher encounter where Allah inspired his servant with whatever he inspired. There's secrecy here. مَا كَذَبَ الْفُؤَادُ, the chest is not lying in what it saw. أَفَتُمَارُونَهُ عَلَى مَا يَرَى, are you going to argue with him with what he saw? لَقَدْ رَأَى مِنْ آيَاتِ رَبِّهِ الْكُبْرَى, he saw of the most amazing miracles and signs of his Lord. Then the Prophet ﷺ goes back down and he tells us many things that he saw on the way down. It is almost impossible to piece together the exact order of events. We simply have a hadith. There's a very long hadith in Musnad Imam Ahmad where the Prophet ﷺ mentions, on the night that I went on Isra wal Mi'raj, I smelt a fragrance that was very sweet. And so I asked Jibreel, what is this beautiful fragrance? So Jibreel said, this is the fragrance of the one who used to comb the hair of the daughter of Fir'aun and her children. So the Prophet ﷺ said, I asked Jibreel, what is their story? How come their fragrance is so strong? So Jibreel said, once when she was combing the hair of the daughter of Fir'aun, the comb fell from her hands and she said, Bismillah. So the daughter said, surely you mean the name of my father, because for her daughter's perspective, my father is God. And so this woman said, no, my Lord and your Lord is Allah, and the Lord of your father is Allah. And the girl said, do you want me to tell my father you said this? And this woman, whose name we don't even know, said, yes, go ahead. And so when Fir'aun found out, he called this slave girl and asked her, are you saying you have a Rabb besides me? Because Fir'aun used to say, أَنَا رَبُّكُمُ الْأَعْلَى. And Fir'aun used to say, as the Quran says, قَالَ هَلْ عَلِمْتُ لَكُمْ إِلَٰهٍ غَيْرِي, did I ever teach you there's another God besides me? Because he has to teach his people about God. And this is exactly what he asked this lady as well. She said, yes, my Lord and your Lord is Allah. And so Fir'aun ordered that a cauldron be put of fire, and it was boiled in front of her, and she was told that she has to throw her own children into the fire, one by one, or else acknowledge Fir'aun as her Rabb. She said, I have one request, O Fir'aun. Fir'aun said, what? He said, that you bury me and my children all together. You take all of our flesh and bones and you bury them in one location. So Fir'aun said, this is a condition that we have upon you. And so one by one, her children were thrown in until finally the last one that was left was her baby that was suckling at her bosom. And this was the one that she could not, she paused at. And so the baby spoke to his own mother and said, oh my mother, go forth and drop yourself in, because this punishment of this world is nothing compared to the punishment of the next. And so she threw herself in. And what is amazing is that, subhanAllah, we don't even know her name. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam recorded her plight and narrated it to the Ummah. Her courage and bravery, Allah had willed that it would be preserved for the Ummah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam also said in Sahih Bukhari, then I entered into Jannah, and there are some versions of the hadith which says, I saw Jannah, and that's different than saying enter Jannah. And I saw in it tents made out of pearls, and I saw that the soil of Jannah was made out of musk. The Prophet ﷺ also said he saw many of the punishments of hell. So in one hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said, I saw the punishment of the one who stole an orphan's money, that they had noses like that of camels, and they would be eating coals made out of fire, and their mouths would swallow these coals, and it would come out through their anuses. The Prophet ﷺ said in one hadith that he saw people who had nails of copper, and they were scratching their bodies and their faces with this, and these were the people who used to backbite. The Prophet said, I saw people, they had in front of them pure meat, and they had rotten infested meat. And they were eating the rotten and infested meat and avoiding the pure meat. I said to Jibreel, who are these people? And Jibreel said, these are the people that used to fornicate. They would leave the halal, meaning their spouses, and they would go to the haram. In another hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said that he saw people with such large bellies that they could not stand up. They were on the ground, and animals were being brought over them to trample over them as a punishment. And when he asked who they were, Jibreel said, these were the people who would get their money from riba. And the Prophet ﷺ also said that he saw people who were cutting their own lips and their tongues, wal'iyadu billah, with scissors of copper and scissors of punishment and fire. He asked Jibreel who these people were. Jibreel said, these were the people who used to tell others to do good and they would forget themselves. The Prophet ﷺ also said, and I saw Dajjal, and one of his eyes was bloated. In another hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said that I saw Dajjal, and I will tell you something about Dajjal that no other prophet has ever told his people, and that is that his left eye is like a rotten grape. And the Prophet ﷺ said, know that Dajjal is a'war, and a'war is one-eyed. The Prophet ﷺ came back down to Jerusalem, and he then rerode Buraq. So Buraq is tied up in Jerusalem, right? Remember, Buraq is an animal that is for this world to transport him from Mecca to Jerusalem. As for the transportation from Jerusalem to the heavens, this is what is called Al-Mi'raj. So when he gets back down to Jerusalem, he then rides the Buraq back to Medina. And there are some narrations that are not fully authentic, but there's no problem in them to affirm them as well, that the Prophet ﷺ passed by three caravans of the Quraysh that he recognized. When he came back to Mecca, the Prophet ﷺ went back to sleep, he said, and he woke up in the Haram. And this clearly shows, therefore, that the actual Isra took place from the Haram itself to Baytul Maqdis and then back to the Haram. For the Prophet ﷺ said, when I woke up the next morning, I felt an anxiety about how am I going to tell the people of what happened to me, and what will they say, and they are going to reject me. And as I was sitting, anxious and nervous and worried, he's sitting in front of the Kaaba, the enemy of Allah, Abu Jahl, passed by me and he saw me in that state. And so Abu Jahl said to him in a sarcastic manner, what is the matter with you? Why, has anything happened? The Prophet ﷺ said, yes, something happened. So Abu Jahl said, what? So the Prophet ﷺ said, yesterday, last night, I was taken from here to Jerusalem. So Abu Jahl was shocked and he said, and you are now here amongst us? You're now waking up amongst us? And so the Prophet himself said, he didn't know whether to make fun of me then or to wait so that I would not retract when he called the other people. The Prophet said, yes, I'm waking up amongst you here. So Abu Jahl said, if I call your people, meaning the Quraysh, will you tell them what you have just told me? And so the Prophet said, yes, I will. And so Abu Jahl began screaming out to the people, Hayya ma'shara Bani Ka'b ibn Lu'ay, which is the great grandfather of the Quraysh. Come forth, we have an announcement to make. And so the people came slowly from the places of Mecca. And so Abu Jahl says, tell them what you promised you would tell them. And so the Prophet ﷺ said, last night I went to Bayt al-Maqdis and I went to pray in the Masjid al-Aqsa, the Bayt al-Maqdis. So the people began reacting in different ways. Some of them began musaffiq, just like clapping, like in what is going on here. Others put their hands on their heads, not knowing what to do. And others began snickering and laughing, until one of them said, and he had been there to Bayt al-Maqdis, can you describe it for us? Because everybody knew that the Prophet ﷺ had never been to Bayt al-Maqdis, right? And so the Prophet ﷺ said, I began describing the Bayt al-Maqdis until they began to ask me about specifics that I wasn't able to recall. I got confused and I became so worried and anxious that I wasn't able to answer, that I had never been so worried before, and he said, as I was waiting for what to respond, I saw in the distance Baytul Maqdis rising up in front of me. Until I saw it descending beyond the house of Aqil ibn Abi Talib, and this is the house that he grew up in, because Abu Talib had died, and Aqil is now living in it, right? The house that he grew up in, not the house he's currently living in, that's Khadija's house. And no question they asked of me, except that I saw the Baytul Maqdis, right, basically being shown to me, and I looked at them and I answered every question that they had, until finally one of them said, as for the descriptions of Baytul Maqdis, then of Jerusalem, then he is accurate. The Prophet ﷺ said, and Ibn Hisham mentions this, I will give you some signs as well. And he mentioned the three caravans. He mentioned the first caravan is of so-and-so, and they will be returning soon because they were the closest to the city. The second caravan is so-and-so, and they had lost a camel, and you can ask them about that camel, they were searching for it. The third caravan is such and such, and they had this urn of water that I drank from. Abu Jahl said, if you saw them at such and such a place, the caravan should be coming right now, because it was very close to Mecca. And while they're discussing, the news arrives that the caravan is entering Mecca. And so Abu Jahl goes and sees, and it is exactly as the Prophet ﷺ described, and he comes back and saying, this is clear sorcery. And of course it was at this time when one of the Quraysh came running to Abu Bakr and said, do you know what your companion has just said? Said what? He said, your companion claims to have gone all the way to Jerusalem, which is a month's journey, and back, which is another month's journey, and he did all of this in one night. Abu Bakr said, if he said that, then it must be true. So the man said to him, do you believe him in such a claim? And so Abu Bakr said, I believe him in something that is even more amazing than this. He claims that the revelation from above the seven heavens comes to him instantaneously. Which is more amazing? Just to go to Jerusalem and come back, or that Allah is communicating with him instantaneously? And so because of this, Abu Bakr was called As-Siddiq. If you think about it, in this journey of Isra wal Mi'raj, the Prophet ﷺ physically saw all of the pillars of Iman. He saw the hijab of Allah, and he spoke directly with Allah. He saw numerous angels, and he saw the angel Jibreel in the original form. He met all of the prophets, and he spoke to them. And this is the prophets in the books, right? And he spoke to them about the day of judgment, and he spoke to them about the signs of the day of judgment. And he saw heaven and hell, which are going to take place after the day of judgment. And he even saw the reality of Qadr. How? When the Prophet ﷺ went up and he saw Adam alayhi salam, he actually saw Adam surrounded by many, many people beyond what he could count. And on the right side of Adam was one group, on the left side another group. And when he saw Adam alayhi salam, saw the people on his right, he was happy. And when he saw the people on the left, he began to cry. So he asked Jibreel about this, and Jibreel said, these are all of the children of Adam. The Ashabul Yameen are the people of Jannah. The Ashabul Shimal are the people of Jahannam. So when he looks at the people of Jannah, he's happy. And when he looks at the people of Jahannam, he is saddened. By seeing Adam with the right and the left, and by, one more thing, the pen, the writing of the pen, hearing the pen. The Iman of the Prophet ﷺ, after literally seeing with his own eyes all of these pillars of Iman, you understand that this was a personal gift to the Prophet ﷺ to increase his own Iman.
I actually enjoyed watching this, and thank you for suggesting it. The entire time I've been thinking, since my first part of this video, I've been thinking, was he having a dream? Through his dream he experienced this night journey, or was it one of those things where maybe you're awake but you're in some sort of trance? You're experiencing a life without physically living where you are. Also, I wanted to ask about Gabriel, the angel Gabriel. Is there any other angel that's actually mentioned by name and told what they did? Or maybe the most important of those that have been written down is just Gabriel. Otherwise, this was very, very interesting to listen to some. I don't think it's impossible that he actually experienced this or this journey. It doesn't shock me. I think it's possible for him to have actually experienced this journey. My only question is, how did he actually experience it? Was it through dreams, or, like I said, through some sort of trance that people don't understand, or I don't understand? Otherwise, this was a very, very good video, good narration, and I actually enjoyed listening to this. I enjoyed learning about all the things that were mentioned in this video, very, very interesting stuff. Let me know if you guys have anything to say about this. Let us know in the comment section below and we'll be very, very appreciative. Make sure to give this video a thumbs up, share it with friends, and of course do not forget to subscribe, and I'll see you in my next reaction video.